Hi everyone, thank you very much for joining us today for our webinar. My name is Laura Hoke and I am the Sustainable Science Groups Coordinator at NESI and I will be your host for today. Today's webinar is entitled Making the Transition Towards a Sustainable Economy, and it is presented by Dr. Piergiuseppe Morone, who's a full professor of economic policy at the University at the University of Rome. I'm not sure why it's not on slideshow mode. Oh, I guess it is. Great. Okay, so I also, before we begin, I want to make sure I thank our sponsors. So today, webinar hosting is being provided by the Green Chemistry and Commerce Council. So I want to say a big thank you to them for helping us out. Before I begin, I want to give you a little bit of background about NESI. So what NESI stands for is the Network of Early Career Sustainable Scientists and Engineers. We are an international organization dedicated to supporting the development of early career sustainable science researchers and professionals. We are an all-volunteer organization run by and for early career scientists dedicated to working together towards a sustainable future. If you're interested in learning more about us, you can find our information here at our website, which is sustainablescientists.org, or follow us on Twitter or like us on Facebook. So just as an example of some of the things that NESI does, so we provide, we try to provide some inspiration by doing interviews with well-known researchers in the field. We try to help build community through both online and on the ground. You know, we try to help provide training and run events such as this webinar, as well as partner with other organizations and facilitate mentoring. So without further ado, I would like to introduce you to our presenter today. So I'm here, this is me, I'm based outside of Boston in Winchester, Massachusetts, and I am the Sustainable Science Groups Coordinator for NESI, and our presenter, Dr. Piergiuseppe Morone, is an economist and full professor of economic policy at the University of Rome, as I mentioned, and he has a very strong interest in sustainability transitions and bio-based economy, putting his research at the interface between innovation, bioeconomics, and chemistry, making him extremely well-suited for being a presenter of a NESI webinar. So he will be talking to you today about what needs to happen to make the transition over to a more sustainable economy happen. So without further ado, let me turn the controls over to Professor Morone and let him tell you about his work. So Professor Morone, you should have the controls.
Yeah, okay. Thank you very much, Laura, for your introducing me and for inviting me to give this seminar today. And I wish to thanks also Cristiano for inviting me. And I'm really pleased to be able to talk to you about this research of my ongoing research of mine about transition towards a sustainable economy, what is called a sustainability transition in this growing body of literature, economic and political economy literature. So let me start. Looking backward. The whole lecture will be about looking forward, but I'd like to start looking backward first. So this is just to tell you that the economic history of humankind over the last 200 years or so has been characterized by several big changes that have occurred over over time. Each phase that has been labeled by the Russian economist Kondratiev, long wave, and afterwards by Schumpeter, named after in honor of Kondratiev, who first introduced this kind of wave, they were named Kondratiev waves. Each one of these waves lasts for approximately 50 to 60 years, and this is a new concept that was introduced in 1925 for the first time by Kondratiev in the economic literature, which counters the usual idea of wave, which is typically the business cycle or the real business cycle, which lasts for a shorter, definitely shorter period of time. So these kind of waves are associated to some kind of radical change that is occurring at some point in time, and in the work of Schumpeter, this radical change is definitely associated with the introduction of a new radical innovation. In fact, in the work of Schumpeter, we can distinguish between incremental innovation and radical innovation. So incremental innovation is all that kind of innovation that adds up to existing, major innovation. Whereas the radical innovation, it's something that is completely new, and bringing a strong change into the economy. What is what was called by Schumpeter himself as a disruptive creation. So creating something completely new, disrupting what is existing there. So initially, in the work of Kondratiev and Schumpeter, there were identified three waves. As I said, each one lasting for approximately 50 to 60 years, and these were associated by Schumpeter to some major technological change, which are basically the first industrial revolution, where the steam engine was introduced and the cotton sector was quickly developed. The first wave, as any other succeeding wave, was characterized by a prosperity period, so basically an upward swing of the wave, which was subsequently followed by a recession, so a peak and then a downswing, which was characterized by a recession period, which turned into a depression and eventually a recovery when the new wave was kicking in. So the first wave was is associated to the first industrial revolution. The second one is associated to the introduction of railway system and steel industry. The third wave was associated with the electrical engineering and chemistry sectors, whereas the fourth wave, which started basically in the 50s, after the Great Depression of 29, is associated with the petrochemical sector and automobiles, and the last wave, the one where we are actually living in today, is the one started right after the oil crisis of 1979, and this is the one associated with the starting in the 80s and associated with ICT, the information and communication technologies. Of course, these waves are the upswing and downswing of this phase refer somehow to the diffusion patterns of new technologies in the market. In the work of Roger, this is going to have an S-shaped, it's following an S-shaped curve, which is basically resembling the entrance into the market of inventors, early adopters, followed by early majority, and then late majority, and then late laggards, those that adopt at last. And this is bringing to saturation. So as the technology diffuses, then we get to the peak of the upswing, and then we turn into a recession, depression, and eventually recovery. So this is like just to tell you that over the last years there have been a lot of change, a lot of big major changes if we look backward. Now we have to look forward and we have to start asking ourselves whether we are heading towards a sixth quantitative wave. In order to answer to this question, we will look at some key characteristic of a change which were identified originally by the same quantitative. So the idea here is that in order to have a change from one wave to another one, so we really need to have these five elements has to be somehow satisfied. So there has to be the exhausting of an old innovation, there has to be excess financial capital in the economy, a period of severe recession, there must be some social and institutional big transformation ahead, and new technologies at the horizon have to be able to overcome the macroeconomic bottlenecks. I will go now through each one of these points to see whether we can claim that we are heading towards a sixth wave. So if we look at the first question is whether there is the exhaustion of the previous wave. So the idea is that we have to look at ICT and to see whether the impact of ICT is slowing down in terms of productivity rise. The debate about the relation between productivity and ICT is always been kind of controversial and has always attracted a lot of attention from economists. In fact, back in the mid 80s, the Nobel Prize winner laureate Robert Solow stated in a rather provocative way that at the time you could see computers everywhere, but in the productivity statistics. Basically, this that is known now as the Solow paradox was basically telling us that Solow was saying that there was no real evidence between the introduction of computers and ICT and a strong impact on productivity, so a big jump in productivity levels. Starting from these. From the statement of Solow, economists started looking investigating more thoroughly the relation between productivity and ICT, and eventually they realized that there was a significant correlation between the introduction and of ICT and productivity, and the problem was that this was taking some time to show up, because there was a lag from the moment in which you introduce this new technology and the time where the productivity rise shows up due to adaptation, some kind of time for adaptation. And there was also another issue, which is basically related to the fact that the productivity rise was associated to the introduction of ICT that was done along with other changes, for example, workforce requalification and as well as workforce reorganization. Bearing these things in mind, economists could confidently say that there was a big relation between ICT and productivity. And if we look at the statistics that are made putting together correlating these two variables, we can see that as far as we any new improvement in terms of ICT, although it's boosting productivity, is boosting at a slowing pace. So basically, the impact of new computers, new models of computers, new memories is positive but is slowing down. So if we have to give an answer to this first question, we could probably say that yes, the new the old technology, the technology associated with the fifth wave, so basically ICT, is some kind of slowing down its impact on the economy. Then we look at the second question, which relates to the financial capital, excess of financial capital, and well, probably this is something that is quite well known, starting from the 2007-2008 outbreak of the financial crisis, that there is a big gap between the value of the goods and services produced and the amount and the value of the economy if we look at the financial derivatives. Basically, if we look at these are data from 2010, and they're showing that the total amount of value of the goods and services produced at the globe level is equal to $63 trillion. And it's the value of the economy, if we look at the financial derivatives, is just tenfold. It's $601 trillion, so almost 10 times as bigger as the real economy value. So probably, yes, there is an excess of financial capital at present in the economy. So we look at the third issue, which is basically relating to the recession period. And we said that this, in order to have a changing phase, we need to be on the downswing of the quantitative wave, which is basically associated with a recession which turns into a depression. So it's not just a short-term phenomenon, which occurs oftentimes in during economic during the economic life of any countries, but we are talking about a prolonged recession, which turns into a depression. So usually, when you have a short period phenomenon, like a short period recession, you have usually what is called a V-shaped recovery. So basically, you have a slump, so the production goes down very quick and reaches a bottom, and then you have a recovery, which brings the economy up to the same level of before the crisis started, before the recession started. If we look at the data of the 2007-2008 financial crisis, then we can definitely say that this V-shaped recovery did not occur. In fact, if we look at the figure that I'm showing you now on this slide, you can see that although there was a recovery phase, this was followed by a much longer declining in GDP at global level, and the figures are even more severe if we look at the GDP of high-income countries, of richest countries, where basically the GDP is being very close to zero for almost five to six years. So this is really showing that this is not a short, short-term phenomenon, but this is something bigger. It's a severe and long recession, which turned into a depression period. Then we look at the fourth question, which is related to the social and institutional transformation. In order to answer to this question, I want to draw your attention on the what has been recently called the mega trends. These mega trends refer both to the so-called demographic transition, which is due to finish in at least another 35 years. Basically, here researchers, analysts, are international organizations like the UN are saying that basically, at least until 2050, the world population is going to grow by another 1 billion or 2 billion people, depending on the kind of scenario. The figure on the left here is showing three different fertility scenarios, and as you can see, even in the green line, which is the low fertility scenario, the population is going to grow until 2050, and then it's going to reach a peak, and then slowly going down. So basically, the demographic transition is not going to is going to last for another 35 years, and as most analysts would agree, the world population is going to grow by at least another 2 billion people, and most of the population growth is going to be concentrated in the African in African countries, where probably there is going to be another billion people population in terms of population growth by 2050. Along with this phenomenon, there is also another big phenomenon that is going to occur over the next 35 years, so from now to until 2050, and this is the so-called explosion of the middle class. So basically, the idea here is that the amount of people that is going to have an income that can be that falls within a middle class level, and by middle class we refer to an income which is anywhere between 6,000 and 30,000 US dollar per capita per year in PPP, purchasing power parity. This bracket is very relevant because after the 6,000 threshold, the $6,000 per year threshold, economists have observed that there is a kick in the demand function. So basically, the amount of the demand start growing faster. So there is an issue related with the demand elasticity, which changes after the $6,000 per year per person per capital threshold. So, and basically, this is telling us that if we are really going to have by 2050 4 billion people, which means basically half of the population by the time, which will be classified as middle class. So with an income falling in these brackets, 6,000, 30,000, there's going to be a huge increase in the demand of food, manufactured goods, services, all the kind of things that people are demanding in high-income countries now are going to be demand also in countries that at present are classified as low, medium-low or medium-high-income countries. Most of the growth of income growth is going to be concentrated, as you can see from the graph shown here, in Asian and Pacific countries, so basically we're talking about China, India, Australia, and these countries are going to bloom over the next 35 years. So there are these two mega trends that are indeed showing that there are going to be some big social and institutional transformation. Because along with this demographic trend and economic trend, probably there's going to be some big changes also in terms of democratic structure of some of these countries, human rights, demands for human rights, and so on and so forth. So indeed, this whole picture of megatrends is showing that there are some big change ahead of us and transformation ahead of us. Now to go to the last question, which is tightly related to the fourth one that we just addressed. So there are technologies able to overcome the bottlenecks, the macroeconomic bottlenecks, which we are facing in the 21st century. And in order to answer to this question, we really want to ask ourselves first, what are the bottlenecks that we are facing in the 21st century? As I see the situation and the dynamic that we've been discussing about so far, I think that the main bottlenecks are really related to this mega trend we've been discussing. If the world population is going to grow by 2 billion people, and most of this, the bulk of this growth is going to be in Africa, then there is a big issue related to the food supply, food security, and food supply to people, to the new to the new 2 billion people that will be populating the world. As we know nowadays, there is almost 1 billion people, just below eight, something like 890,000 million people living in starvation, so basically without getting enough food for enough calorie content in their diet, daily the daily calorie amount, which is letting them living in a decent way, and the risk is that this figure is going to increase rather than decrease. The other bottleneck relates to the fact that as much as the food industry is going to be put under pressure by the population growth, if we look at population growth and we match it with the figures about the middle class, blooming of the middle class, the explosion of the middle class, then there's going to be a huge increase in demand of manufactured goods, which is going to put a lot of pressure in terms of production and therefore in terms of emissions of greenhouse gases. So the global pollutant like CO2 is going to be the amount of CO2 is going to, at if we look at the business as usual scenario, the amount of CO2 is going to increase significantly over the next years. Therefore, this is really something that should be considered, taken into serious consideration, and this is indeed a bottleneck that is ahead of us and we have to face. Then we have another issue which relates to both of these things. So the increasing demand is linked to the fact that to the amount of waste that is produced at a global scale. So if the world population is going to grow and there's going to be a much higher demand in terms of food and manufactured goods, there's going the problem that we're facing today, which is related to the amount of waste that is produced, is going to be even more severe over the next 35 to 50 years. So basically we have to find ways of handling and managing this huge amount of waste in a more efficient way, or better, reducing the amount of waste that is produced. Getting out of the carbon circle issue, there are also some other bottlenecks which are related to the fact that there are several elements that are becoming a critical element. If we look at this table that was produced by the Royal Chemistry Society, we can see that there are already quite a few elements in the periodic table of elements showing a red flag, where a red flag means that basically this, if we keep using at the pace that we're using them today, at the same rate of exploitation that we're using them today, these elements in red, those showing a red flag, are going to disappear over the next 100 years or so. Those with red and yellow are going to disappear over a longer period of time, and those in yellow are become limited, are going to be limitedly available, and are going to be on future risk to supply. So basically there are some elements that are disappearing. Some of these are really relevant. If we look, for example, at the indium, this is, if we keep using at the same rate we're using it today, in less than 13 years, we are going to completely exhaust all the indium that we have on our planet. And this is also kind of striking back to the carbon circle issue, because indium, for example, is one of the materials that is used for constructing solar panels. Therefore, it's an element that is very relevant for constructing clean energy. So basically, if we cannot construct solar panel, then we have to turn back to the carbon energy. So all these things are tightly linked one with the other. Then we have this hypothesis of the sixth wave. So basically, if we have agree that all these issues that I've been mentioning are kind of pointing that the system is going towards a sixth wave, then we have to ask ourselves what this sixth wave is going to be like, what is going to be the key technological radical innovation that is going to mark this new era, mark this new long wave. As I see it, as I perceive it, this new wave is going to be characterized by a new age of sustainability. So it has to be characterized by resource efficiency, clean technologies, more efficient production systems, new production and consumption behaviors, and a more efficient way of handling waste that we are producing. So basically, there are two key elements that are characterizing this new wave, which are relating to the production side of the economy and to the demand side of the economy, to the consumption side of the economy. And the idea here is that if we want to have, if this wave, this new wave, is going to lead towards a new sustainable growth, so basically we really need to go towards what is called decoupling. We need to have a decoupling of the GDP growth, so the economic growth, which one of the way of measuring growth, economic growth, and the resource use and environmental impact. So there are two kind of decoupling concept here. One relates to resource decoupling, and the other one relates to the impact decoupling. The underlying idea is that we really want to go towards an economic system which is producing more and producing not necessarily more goods, as I will say, but producing more human wealth, and which is somehow resembled in the production of GDP, although some might argue against this idea, and but reducing the amount of resources of natural resources that we are using, and most importantly reducing the environmental impact of this production system. So we really want to make a big change into the production system in order to create this decoupling of economic growth and, on the one hand, and environmental impact on the other hand. In order to go towards this decoupling, we have to look at the production and consumption system. The production and consumption system, as it been perceived until recently, has been basically perceived as a linear dynamic, where you basically have extraction of resources, which are used as inputs for production of goods, which are sold in the market and are bought by consumers. The consumers are getting utility from the consumption, and then what is left over, both at the production level and the consumption level, is waste. We have to turn into a circular economy kind of model, where we basically have an efficient reuse of all waste that is produced at the production level, an efficient reuse of all waste that is produced at the consumption level, and we reduce the amount of goods that we consume, we recycle, and we use more in a more intelligent way what we are consuming. So basically, there are two issues here. On the one hand, we have to reuse, recycle more and more. On the other hand, we have to get out of the mass consumption model that has been the driving model of the economy over the 20th century. So basically, the idea is that we really need big changes occurring at the production level, big changes occurring at the consumption level. We need some kind of paradigm shift, both at the production level and the consumption level. In order to go toward in this direction, so can I go back one slide?
Yes, you should be able to just click the back arrow on your keyboard.
Okay. It's not working really. Oh, yeah, sorry. Yeah, that's the slide. On the production side, some of these major changes can be associated, for example, to the green biorefinery or third generation biorefinery, where we are using, where we're basically shifting from a traditional refinery which is using fossil fuel as an input, producing energy, fuels, solvent, plastics, chemicals, fibers, and whatever, into a new kind of refinery which is using the biorefinery, which is using biomasses as an input and is producing exactly the same kind of output. But here, what is the major difference here is that we are not using the carbon, but we're using green biomasses. And more interestingly, we can use waste biomasses, like urban bio-waste, or bio-waste that is produced in the local the actual level. There are huge amounts of waste feedstocks that can be used in order to produce all these products. And you probably, some of you at least, know better than me. The technology is getting there. There are some working example of third generation biorefineries. I was recently visiting a city in the south of Italy, Gela, which is in Sicily, where the Eni, which is the largest Italian national company of petrol and gas, is actually turning a traditional refinery into a biorefinery. And of course, there is a lot of attention on this transition by local policymaker, grassroots association, because of course there are big issues associated with employment and local community development. So they see this as a big opportunity for them, but they really want to be sure that there is not going to be a big decrease in terms of level of employment, and they really want to make this transition to be effective in economic terms also for the local community. Then if we look at the consumption side, okay, if we look at the consumption side, there are also big changes that are occurring. The whole debate about the sharing economy is quite relevant, and it's gaining momentum. The idea here is that what is really making an increase in human wealth is not owning as many goods as possible, which is typically a concept of the 20th century. So where the idea of ownership was the key measure of your wealth, but is actually we are turning into a society where more relevant than owning something is getting access to something. Something that you need. There is the power drill story that is saying that basically almost everybody has a power drill in his house, but the average use of a power drill is of something like 13 minutes in its entire life. So the question is, do we really need to have to own a power drill, or wouldn't that be better to get access, to have access to a power drill anytime we want? When we buy a power drill, we don't really buy the tool, the machine, but what we really want is something that, what we really want is to make a hole in the wall. So basically, our utility is a function not of owning the good itself, but actually of being able to get what we want, which in this case is making a hole in the wall. So the idea is that we are turning into a society where more and more the access is becoming the issue of wealth and utility more than ownership. Now, I want to conclude my talk today giving you some insights from a research that I've been conducting over the last 6 months. Looking at the sharing economy and getting insights from the sharing economy, I thought that it could have been interesting to use this idea of sharing economy to assess and to study the food waste reduction. You probably know that there is a huge amount of food wasted along the whole food supply chain, and what is really striking to me is that in high-income countries, mostly USA, Canada, and Europe, the amount of waste that occurs at the family level, at the consumption level, at the household level, can get as high as 40-45%, which is huge, which is a huge figure, because we are talking about almost half of the shopping that we are doing that is thrown away. And this, we are talking about perfectly, in most of the cases, we're talking about perfectly eatable food. So the idea is, my research idea here is whether we can combine the sharing economy principle, the new ideas that are growing up around the sharing economy with the food with reduction of food waste. So can we introduce some kind of food sharing practices that could lead to a reduction in food sharing? In order to assess this, to test this hypothesis, we conducted a field experiment. Specifically, we did a framed field experiment where we basically worked with the students sharing private accommodations. And the idea is that this is a framed field experiment. So students knew that they were taking part of an experiment, and they knew that their behaviors was going to be recorded and scrutinized afterwards. This using the framed field experiment could allowed us to establish a clear causal link, the existence or not of a clear causal link between the introduction of sharing practices, of food sharing practices, and the reduction of food waste. If so, the experiment we ran the pilot experiment with some 20 students. So we selected 5 households, students aged between 18 and 25. Household size was ranging between 3 and 5, and we preliminarily collected some social demographic data and some data information about students' lifestyle and diets. Then we ran two experimental treatments. One was the control treatment, and the other one was the food sharing treatment. So the control treatment was conducted in this way. It started on a Monday, on Monday morning, and subjects were instructed to behave according to their regular food consumption habits. Each subject was endowed with 30 euros, and was told that this money could be used for doing their food shopping, or could be saved. The leftover money could be saved. Then we collected the food shopping receipt on Wednesday evening, and twice during the week we collected the waste. We asked them to separate organic food waste from other types of waste, and on Wednesday evening and on Friday evening we collected the food waste, the organic food waste, and we weighted it. So we had a clear measure of the amount of waste that was produced during the week, during the whole week. And then on Friday evening the control treatment ended. Then the food sharing treatment was identical to the control treatment, but this time students were told to buy food together, to the household had to go together to do the food shopping, and had to consume the food together. So they had to cook together and consume the food together. Again, we collected the waste on Wednesday and on Friday, and we compared, by comparing the waste collected in the control treatment and the food sharing treatment, we could get some information, some insight about the impact of introducing this sharing practice in terms of on the amount of food waste produced. To make a long story short, the results that we got is that basically not all the family reduced the amount of food waste in the sharing treatment, but 3 out of 5 did reduce, and those family were those that had previously experienced separate waste collection, those that had some kind of higher domestic skills. So they knew, they were more aware, they knew better how to cook, and they also had more collaborative behaviors. These are kind of information that we matched by the preliminary questionnaire we submitted to the students. So basically the core message that we got from this pilot experiment is that the sharing practice did work in terms of reducing the amount of food waste, but only if there was some kind of readiness from the consumptions from the student side in order to make the most out of this consumption. So the message that we got is that, yes, food sharing could be a valuable tool for reducing food waste, but you really need to kind of have a readiness by the people in order to make this this working. So in order, I'm just going now to wrap up and conclude. As I said, the question that I posed at the beginning is, are we heading towards a sixth conductive wave? And we said that this conductive wave, if it is happening, is going to be most likely a green wave, a green technology associated to green technology. The core message that I want to deliver today is that if we have to make this jump into the sixth conductive wave, then we really have to make big changes. Still, there are big changes to be made, both the production level. And here is the place where the technology development is playing a very relevant role. But we also need to make big change to the consumption level. So we have to get out of a mass consumption society to turn it into something new, where consumption is done in a more aware, with a higher awareness, and in a more sustainable way. So thank you very much.
So I want to say thank you very much, Professor Morone, for that very insightful talk. So for those of you listening in, if you would like to ask any questions, please type them in the chat box that is on the right-hand side of your screen. So if you do have any questions, I will read them out loud, and then Professor Morone will be able to answer those. So just to give you some time to enter some questions, I'll start off with, I have a few. Actually, you were really great, Professor Morone, at answering them as you went along. So I actually have a whole bunch of questions here on my sheet that I've now crossed out because you already answered them. So, which is really good. But so my one of the really big questions I have is just that, you know, obviously I think it is really important to get away from this mass consumption model. But, you know, unfortunately, there are a lot of large companies that are very well established that do have a vested interest in maintaining this mass consumption model. So what needs to be done to get away from this and move towards more sharing models or towards the circular economy?
Well, this is a very interesting question. As I said, there is this literature, growing area of literature, which is called sustainability transition, which is basically building on earlier work done in the 80s on technological transition. But the new insight that has been brought about by this new streams of literature is that they're looking at, well, I'm part of this, so I would say we're looking at the transition as the model as a multi-level perspective. So basically we have some kind of different layer acting all together, and the transition is really the outcome of the co-interaction of this layer. The idea is that we have the dominant and the well and established social technological regime, which is nowadays is the carbon fossil fuel based economy. Here we have big companies that are established. We have a regulation system that is designed in order to fulfill the requirements of this system, of this incumbent socio-technological regime. We have infrastructure that are designed for this system. If you think about cities as they look today, they are very different from cities in the Middle Age. Why? Because they are designed in order to let cars drive in, and we have gas station almost everywhere in big cities. So it's a very stable configuration. Because of this, it's a very stable configuration. However, as I said, changes are possible. And the economic history of the last 200 years is showing that these kind of changes are possible. Big changes are possible. They can occur. But in order to occur, we really need to have two things happening at the same time. We need to have a sufficient pressure coming from the top level of this multi-level perspective. So where we are at the center of this model, we have this the established the dominant technological regime. So we need to have sufficient pressure coming from the top, from the landscape level, what is called landscape level. So this is kind of pressure coming from policymaker, grassroots organization, citizen gathering together and putting pressure. And at the same time, this pressure will open up some kind of windows of opportunities for the change. But at the same time, we really need to have technological niche readiness. So we really need to have a pressure which is matched by a new technology which is ready to replace the old one. And there are examples in the economic history of this kind of change. Think, for example, at the shipping, the sailing ship that have been replaced by steam engine ships. In order to make this change, big infrastructural change were required. For example, the port had to be completely redesigned in order to host this new kind of vessel, this kind of new ships. So. I think that these kind of changes can occur. It's not easy because you have to destabilize a very stable regime, but it is possible.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, no, I think that's actually really that's something that I've in my reading and that I've seen that this pressure is really important. Yeah. So both from policy, but if you live in a place where policy is very progressive, that you do have sort of citizen groups that do work together. So that's good to hear. So while you were answering, a lot of questions came in, so I will just start in order. So the first question from our listeners is, do you know any countries that are really on the right trajectory in terms of consumption and production, and what are they doing right?
There are some examples, yes. For example, Germany is turning its energy production. So there is a whole, a big commitment which is taken both at national government level as well as local government level in order to switch from production of the energy production from fossil fuel to renewable sources. And it's like setting a paradigm for other countries. I have been talking about this recently with some German colleagues of mine, and they are kind of enthusiastic about this change. They are going to develop a kind of best practice model, and they really want to make become leading country in Europe on this. On the consumption side, the issue about sharing economy is very complicated because this is very new. The research on sharing economy is very new, and I was recently in San Francisco on a conference. One of the tracks of this conference was on sharing economy, and the core message is that there is still a lot of confusion about the definition of sharing economy. What is sharing economy? Because there are some consumption behaviors, like for example new consumption behaviors which are really cannot be classified, they're considered as sharing practices. For example, if you consider Uber is really sharing economy, or is it like just making a new cab system, making the best out of the platform? So there are a lot of things that are happening all together, and some of them can be really classified as sharing economy. Some others, as I see it, are not really sharing economy, but are something different.
Very interesting. So the next question is actually specifically about slide 15. So maybe we can go back to slide 15. Start there. That slide, there we go. That's slide 15, I think. So the human well-being is increasing exponentially. Does this really work? Is there a point where we have to say, yeah, that's enough, I am happy? That's a really good question.
I don't
very
know.
Philosophical one.
Yeah, that's true. It goes well beyond economics. I'm just a poor economist. It's difficult for me to answer this question. And I think that everybody's probably got an answer to this question. As I see it, the feeling of what is associated with a utility increase or human well-being increase is usually an incremental concept. If we look at our parents' generation, let's say generation that was born right after the Second World War, they had much less than we have now in terms of goods and services they could access, but they were like living their youth in a period of at least in Europe in a very booming economy, and so their sense of well-being was growing growing very fast. So it's as I see it, the happiness is always associated to some kind of improvement. The thing is that improvement doesn't have to be understood as more amount of stuff that we can buy or more service that we can get. We can have an improvement in our well-being even if we have some, if we can access more but own less. This is the idea, and there is some evidence about the so-called peak stuff. So basically, there are lots of data that have been collected about the number of cars and a lot of goods. Most relevant studies on cars, and they are saying that we are getting probably to the peak of cars that are being sold. So we are getting into a phase where we are reducing the amount of cars. Does it mean that less people have access to the service of transportation? No, it doesn't mean that. It means that we are changing our consumption behavior, and which basically means that we can decouple the amount of resources that are used with from the increase in human wealth.
That's really interesting. Okay, so next question. So we had a previous webinar, so I should say Nessie had a previous webinar on alternatives to GDP. The use of economic growth as the key measure of a successful economy seems to be the dominant paradigm worldwide. Do you think we need to overcome this?
This is a big issue. Yes, I think we need to overcome this. I think that GDP is really inadequate to measure wealth, and it's getting more and more less and less adequate to measure wealth. There is a very nice video clip on YouTube about a speech given by Kennedy, not JFK Kennedy, but Robert Kennedy, on the limits of GDP as a measure of wealth. We know that if there is an increase in traffic, car traffic in the streets of our cities, this is associated with an increase of GDP. And this is paradoxical. So if from going from A to B, rather than taking 10 minutes, I take 40 minutes because I'm stuck in traffic jam. and I'm using more my car, and I'm using more gas, I'm consuming more gas, then there is, this is going to add up to the GDP, so the GDP is going to increase. And this is really something that it's a paradox, because we associate something that is spoiling our day, producing pollution, with an increase in GDP. So GDP is really not a good measure of wealth, human being wealth. But on the other hand, although there are a lot of efforts in order to find new measures, none of them has been able so far to replace unanimously the, this measure. Therefore, we really need to make an effort in order to replace GDP, but as a matter of fact, we still don't have a measure of GDP which is unanimously considered, a measure of wealth which is unanimously considered an alternative to GDP.
Thank you. Yeah, that car example is a really good one of why there are, why there is this problem with the GDP.
Yeah.
It's like very good illustration. Because sitting in traffic is the worst.
Yeah.
So the next question is, I've read some qualitative praise of housing cooperatives, cross-generational housing, etc. Are there any academic studies on these as they relate to sustainability?
Well, not that I'm aware of. There might be, but I haven't come across these kind of studies.
That's a good question, though. So the next question is, if you were an early career researcher, where do you think are key research needs to help us move towards a more sustainable economy?
I'm not saying this because I'm talking to this network, but green chemistry, I think, is a very core area. Chemistry has been one of the core research area in the 20th century. Traditional chemistry, and I think that green chemistry is going to be as relevant as it traditional chemistry was in the 20th century for the 21st century. So green chemistry is indeed a key area, but of course there is also engineering in order to make to match and scale up the results of this results and the results of this research to industrial level. So these are key areas where I think research is going to play a major role. And it looks these are like the innovation niche I was talking about before. So where the new technology is nourished in a safe environment, is protected from competitive pressure coming from the market, and can really get to a point where it's ready to get into the market. And this is a key area, I think.
Well, as a green, as someone who is studying green chemistry, I'm certainly happy to hear that. But I think also you mentioned with engineering, obviously collaborations are really important,
yeah.
Which is what we focus on here at NESI, so it's good to hear.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, there's still quite a lot of questions. Okay, this one's a bit of a long one, but I will do my best to not screw up while reading it. Significant changes are ahead of us. Most notably, the world population is projected to increase by almost 1 billion people within the next decade, and the global middle class is expected to nearly triple by 2030. These trends add pressure to the world economic system and environment. Greenhouse gas emissions keep growing at a global scale. Materials and energy sources are fast approaching their physical limits, and the amount of waste produced under the current system seems to be reaching a new peak. Against this background, a transition from a society heavily based...
This is my abstract, isn't it?
Oh, so it is. Okay, well then I will stop reading it. Thank you for noticing. Yeah, okay. So the next question that is... Yeah, that was pretty long. That was... pretty long for a question. Okay, so then the next question, talking about the mega trends, in the bottlenecks you mentioned, food waste, mm-hmm. Emissions, and raw materials, parentheses chemicals, could you comment on water availability, particularly clean water availability and distribution?
Yeah, this is another major issue. I'm not really an expert on this, but yes, it's one of the biggest issue to be taken into consideration. Some analysts are saying that the next war will be driven by access to water as a key resource that we are running out very quickly. And yes, this is a major problem. But the whole idea of a circular economy is also looking at the amount of water that is disposed in the production system, and is trying to, on the one hand, is trying to reduce the amount of water that is wasted during the production system, and on the other hand, there are studies that are basically investigating ways of valorizing wasted water that is coming out from the industry production systems. So also on this, the whole idea of making a circular economy is definitely going to reduce the amount of water that is produced. And there are also, at the same time, there are also a lot of studies that are done by agronomists in order to use more efficiently the water in order to increase the amount of biomasses. Because if we are going to turn towards from a fossil fuel-based economy to a bio-based economy, so biomasses, green biomasses, are going to play a key role, and green biomasses have a huge amount of water into them. So we really need to make sure that we are using the water in the most efficient, in the most possibly efficient way.
So that actually leads into our next question really well. It's about the circular economy and how that seems to be a very popular topic in the EU right now, but it's less well known in the US. Do you have any idea as to why that might be?
I think that the major difference, I've been looking at differences between the US and the EU, and I think that the major difference that we have in Europe and in the States relates to the global warming idea. I think, as I see it, in Europe, basically nobody is arguing that there is a human effect on global warming, which is something that is not common knowledge in the US. And probably this could be one of the reason why one of the reason why in Europe we are looking at circular economy with more interest than in the US. And there is also another issue which probably is even more relevant, which is basically access to resources. In Europe, we are relying on resources that we are importing much more than the US is doing. Talking about my country, Italy, we are importing a huge amount of electricity, and energy that we are using is imported. Whereas in the US, you have reached independence, energy self-sufficiency, which is basically a big achievement compared to Europe. So the idea of turning into a circular economy for European countries is basically also reducing the dependence from other countries.
That's very interesting. That's something I've wondered about a lot too, as someone who lives in the US, about why I really don't hear about it too much, but that's a really good point. So we have one more question. So this one is regarding biorefineries that you mentioned. So what do you think we need from an economist point of view to bring new biotechnologies to the market and make them economically viable?
What I'm most interested is third generation bioraffineries, and also the bioraffineries using waste as an input. And in this sense, what is really needed is from an economic point of view, I mean. Is to make studies on market acceptance of these new products that are going to be made from waste. For example, are we sure that the market as it is now is ready to purchase? People, families are ready to purchase plastic dishes or cutlery made out of waste. They can see it as something that is not secure, not clean. So we really need to make an effort in order to prepare the ground for the market to be ready for this new kind of products that are going to be produced. With as I see it and as I hope, more and more from what we call nowadays waste, which is going to be the resource in the future.
That's a really good point. On behalf of the NESI team, I'd really like to thank you again, Professor Morone, for chatting with us today and sharing with us all of the really great information on your slides. So I want to let everyone who's listening in know that we will be posting this recording on our website. And if you are interested in learning more about NESI, please visit our website. And if you want to listen to this webinar recording or others, please check out the NESI webinars page. So again, thank you so much, Professor Morone, and everyone else. Have an excellent afternoon or evening, depending on where you are.
Yeah. Thank you very much for inviting me once again, and thanks for this very nice talking and conversation, Q&A. Okay, good.
All right. Bye, everyone.